I've just been reminded that my sobriety date is September 19th, 1982. November 19th, and it's my daughter's birthday, and there's more magic attached to that sentence than I can possibly begin to tell you. But suffice it to say that 1 year to the day before my daughter was born, I was upside down with my head on the pavement, Mercedes-Benz on top of me, and I was held in by a safety belt that I hadn't put on, and I spent the next 10 days in absolute and complete denial. I am an expert on denial, and I did my level best to not see the inevitable consequences of my acts. Except I couldn't shake the image of this little girl that was in my mind's eye. And every day she got clearer and clearer until on the 19th, I said enough. And she disappeared and didn't reappear for 1 year. She was my daughter. And I think we should start off this evening with something I haven't done in a long, long time, and that's the Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. That is the first, most important, most clear spiritual revelation of my life. It changed me from one thing to another and made me better. One day about 40 years ago, which sounds like a long time ago until you're 63, I found myself loaded to the gills in the living room psychopharmacologist who I didn't know, don't know how I found him, but somehow I knew that he was one of the few who could help me. He was a teacher at UCLA, I remember that, and I knew that he could tell me stuff that I urgently needed to know, like, was I crazy, or how crazy was I? Or could I talk to him until at least I could drive home? And he proceeded to tell me a story, most of which I remember word for word to this day. I hadn't been sent to him. No courts or police were at that moment involved in my life, and I know that I had somehow found him, and he knew things, or might know things that could help explain why I was doing many of the things that I had been doing that so clearly put my goals, my ambitions, my relationships, my life in such utter peril, and why I did these things so ferociously. I knew that I wasn't like some of, or most of the people that I dealt with. They were not constantly trying to alter their head, at least not as openly as I, and they weren't interested in what I was interested in, because I was a smart, talented guy who kept making choices that seemed to make my life harder, like take drugs and insist that my friends and I could talk about things other than money, success, or sex. At least not sex as scoring more than your friends, but sex as part of the true mystery of life and the obvious rewards and dangers that surround it, and mysteries like pleasure and the differences between boys and girls, and why one aroused one and the other didn't. And God has always fascinated me as fact or as metaphor. God works. And the one thing I'd like to say to the young lady is, you didn't harm your relationship to your higher power. That's one relationship that you can never harm. You can harm every other one, but not that one. I was very lonely most of the time in finding people who wanted to talk about the stuff that I wanted to talk about. Only when they were loaded, they were more apt. So when I wasn't acting in class or on TV, which was just as much of a high as drugs, I would seek out the conversation of those who liked what I liked, or I would just get loaded and do it all by myself. I did it for many of the reasons that young people have been doing stupidly risky things forever. I thought I couldn't be killed. I was immortal. And I thought I'd always be smarter and faster. Like when you're playing Cowboys and Indians, and you're really little, and your best friend shoots his invisible gun this many inches away from your head, and you move away and say, "Miss me!" The other reason was, of course, that while I knew I was immortal, I also knew that I was a worthless piece of dog dung, and I couldn't stand myself, and I would do anything to not be me. Sometimes when you're using, you know that if you inhaled that one more line, you would get so paranoid that you could remember so many times that self-hatred would just pour out of your eyes. And I would scream inside, not letting anyone see, of course, that I was such a waste of humanity. Randy Newman wrote the line, "It takes a whole lot of medicine for me to pretend that I'm somebody else." And that was me, sitting right in my head next to the other Richard, who was a prince of heaven. Every once in a while, I would do something that, if it had been just a millisecond different, I would not be here today. I would either be dead or I would be in prison. It would be some public embarrassment, like one night when I thought I was snorting coke, and it turned out to be coke and heroin, and I OD'd in the lap of my buddy sitting next to me, and I could hear them talking about where they were going to dump my body if I didn't wake up. And I remember I was sweating buckets, my clothes were all drenched, but I was high enough to kind of enjoy the conversation of them talking about what they were going to do with Rick's body. And when I woke up, my stomach muscles were tearing at me in an agony of spasms. And my host, my buddy, put a gun in my stomach and said I owed him $100 for that lime heroin that I'd snorted. He was my buddy. He was going to kill me. You'd think that stuff like that would make me think or pause, but all I did was look for the next thing to use. If my parents or the cops or the guy in the next lane was paying even a little more attention, I would never have shot Jaws or been invited here to talk to you, because I'd be dead. Or I'd be crippled.